I hate this mirror so much. It covers a quarter of the wall space in this room, and it really restricts the camera angles that I can use when filming anything in this space. It's frustrating, but luckily I'm an engineer and I solve problems for a living, and so this is the retractable custom photo backdrop that I built to solve my problem. And as I take you through the design and construction process of this project, I'm going to share with you three tips that you can take home for your own 3D printed projects to help make them a little bit easier and a little bit better. If you go back and look at some of my previous videos, you'll see that I've struggled to set up some sort of a filming set. I'm kind of all over the place, maybe in the hallway, in this office. Yeah, I haven't been able to figure it out quite right, because this mirror behind me, it means I can't use it as a backdrop. And if I have to set up a C-stand and cloth and kind of create a backdrop like what I've done behind me, it takes up a lot of space in the room, and there's physically not a lot of space to set up the cameras and the lights and even just to move around. And I'm not the only person who has this kind of problem. There's products like this one that you can buy online right now that you're either ceiling mounted or wall mounted and allow you to roll up and down different colored backdrops for whatever you're doing, whether it's photography, product photography, portraits, whatever. But they're expensive. And let's be honest, you're not here to watch me buy something, you're here to watch me make something. So I'm gonna show you what I designed, what I built in order to solve my problem. So my process started with figuring out what sort of sizing and colors I was gonna need to cover the wall and create the film set that I wanted. And I settled on 6.5 foot by 10 foot backdrops, these ones. And I got them in white, green, and black. And I was gonna use the black mainly for kind of talking to camera shots with a nice clean backdrop. The white I could use maybe for product photography. And then the green, if I ever get into kind of background removal and post-production. I haven't done it before, but maybe I will in the future, and I'm prepared for that now. So these other products that you can buy will generally use a chain that you pull on to raise and lower the backdrops. And I don't really like it. I think it's a little unsightly and I'd like to figure something else out. So what I came across was one of my previous jobs as a mechanical engineer was designing gearboxes for big trucks. And so I thought, how cool would it be if I had a gearbox inspired mechanism to be able to select which backdrop I wanted and then raise and lower it. So what I settled on actually was a planetary gear setup. So I would have a large central gear that could selectively engage three smaller gears. Those smaller gears would be connected to the poles that the backdrops were on. So if I want to lower the black backdrop, for example, I would engage that gear and spin the large central gear, and that could lower the black backdrop. And then of course, I would need a little bit of a shifter mechanism to be able to engage and disengage the different gears to select which backdrop I wanted. So that's the gist of the design. And before I get into the final product and what it looks like, I wanted to share with you the three tips that I had that I used in this project when making mechanisms using 3D printing. These are things that you'll be able to use in any of your projects. So my first tip for you is that you don't always have to use hex nuts in your projects. There's other options out there. In my case, what I used in this were these thermoset internally threaded fasteners, usually called inserts. They have them for wood and for plastic. And the ones that I used have these little teeth on the outside that if you use a soldering iron to heat up the insert, you can then press it into, in my case, 3D printed plastic parts. This melts the plastic, and then when everything cools down, that plastic is now gripping onto the insert, and now you have internal metal threads in your plastic part. This allows for example, if bolts are gonna be tightened and loosened frequently, you're gonna have a much longer lasting engagement there. Of course, the part is now the nut, so you don't need a second wrench to hold your nut and the head of the bolt at the same time. So this can make the assembly process easier, fewer tools needed to service your project. These are all good things. But now there are cons as well. So you know, these threaded fasteners are gonna be a little bit more expensive than just a standard hex nut. So again, you've got trade-offs between these. I find them to be really convenient, like in my project, specifically on the shifter support rods, there was no place to put a hex nut. So I was able to melt in place these inserts and have the internal threads right where I needed them, kind of hidden in plain sight. My second tip for you is to use snap fits where possible. So, you know, using nuts and bolts is great and all, but if you don't need them at all, that's even better. There's a specific type of catch mechanism that you see all over the place, like in this remote control and on the two snaps of my caliper box, where the plastic parts themselves have been designed such that when you engage them together, there's a deflection and then bam, they snap together. And now they hold themselves together without any nuts or bolts. In my case, for this project, I'd use snap fits for the interaction between the large central gear and its mounting axle. So I was able to have 6 snap fit tines, and when you engage the large central gear with them, it snaps in place. And now the snap fits are designed to allow the central gear to spin, but then to not move in any other direction. Designing these can be a little tricky. You need to get a very specific, you know, height and width ratio of that tine so that it has just enough flexibility to engage, but not too much flexibility so that you have no rigidity. So this is a trial by error process. And so if you have a good understanding of your materials, you might be able to get a good guess. There are equations, of course, that can guide you here, but honestly, you really need to understand everything that's going on in your project in all scenarios, and trial by error tends to get you pretty close. And my third tip here is about using your own filament as the pins for inside of hinges. Now, any mechanism is going to have some pivot points, and you could use nuts and bolts, rivets, machined axles, there's all sorts of things that you can use to create just a rod for pivot points to sit on. But your filament, in my case I have 1.75 millimeter PLA filament, it's actually really great for this. It's cylindrical, it's cheap, I can cut it to length, and it's hard and smooth, so there's not a lot of friction in the joints, and it's even got a little bit of flexibility to it, so if there's any misalignment between the bores, the pin is still going to fit through. The filament is great for this. Now, of course, this isn't a super heavy duty thing, right? You know, this isn't going to take hundreds of pounds of loads, but you'd be surprised, it's quite effective. Now, all of these ideas and design tips are baked into my backdrop project, so now let's see how I built it. Well, watching MythBusters for years taught me many things, and one powerful teaching was, when in doubt, more lube. Now, the lubrication was incredibly helpful for getting this mechanism to turn correctly, but there was another thing going on too, and it has to do with the interacting forces between gears. So when you have two gears that are meshed together, one is spinning the other, there's forces involved. There's a tangential force, which is actually getting the gears to spin, and there's also a radial force that's trying to push the two gears apart from each other. This comes from the contact angle between the teeth itself. And so in my head when I was designing this, I thought I was going to need some bearing caps on the top side in order to resist that radial force.
in reality, the pole, the backdrop, the gear, it all has mass. And so there's a force of gravity that's actually counteracting that radial force totally on its own. So part reduction, always a plus, and lubrication, also always a plus. So those two things made this mechanism work flawlessly.
As you can see, I can shift between the different backdrop colors by pushing and pulling on these shifter knobs, and the gears either engage or disengage to select which color. And there's even some other benefits that I hadn't considered with this project. So this large soft surface on a quarter of the room is actually really good at suppressing sounds. All in all, I am incredibly happy with how this project turned out. I mean, when I come into this room and I see that beautiful design above my head, it just puts a smile on my face. And you should remember that too, that making things on your own isn't just about having a functional thing when you're done. It's about enjoying the process of making. It's about knowing that you made that thing afterwards. There's a certain sense of calm and accomplishment inside when you see that. So go make cool stuff and enjoy it after the fact. Thank you for watching, and please like the video if you enjoyed. And I think next video, we're gonna do some more art-based stuff.